Hello again and welcome to Southern Circuit. I'm Rickley Stone. Gordon Scott is a Tallahassee musician who not only plays but repairs stringed instruments. We'll meet him and find out why he gave up a career as a carpenter and English teacher for the sounds of music. The talk is tomatoes in Gadsden County, and we'll learn why when we visit Quincy's Triple M Packing. For many of us, Florida is paradise. Unfortunately, insects see it that way too. But paradise is not lost, thanks to the work of the West Florida Arthropod Research Laboratories in Panama City. We'll stop there for a visit. And just in time, because back in Tallahassee, we'll take to the streets with graffiti artist Ken Shaw. That's our itinerary for this week. We think you're going to enjoy the journey. Stay with us.
When it comes to making a living, most people try to make what they do be what they're best at. Gordon Scott has done exactly that by combining his skills as a craftsman with his love for music.
There was always music around the house of one kind or another. And so I just always heard it and always liked it. My first love is acoustic music. And I've always kind of worked on my own stuff and have been really interested in it and have read and tried to keep up with what's going on, and just gradually I've gotten more involved in the repair and restoration and that sort of thing of acoustic instruments. And so I ended up doing it all the time. I suppose the thing that keeps me interested in it and helps me to enjoy working on instruments is to help people to make their music as good as possible. And you know, it's very personal. You relate with the people whose instruments you're working on. You get to know them. You find out a lot about somebody by working on their guitar or their fiddle or something like that. And so it's just that whole complex of things that makes it fun to do. Well, an old instrument has a lot of things to it. It has, one of the reasons that old instruments sound as good as they do is the wood ages and dries out and becomes more brittle and more resonant. The glues kind of shrink up and dry. And there are a lot of theories about why old instruments sound as good as they do. Being played a lot is a major factor. And for whatever reasons in terms of physics, in terms of vibrations and that sort of thing. I think they loosen up so that they're just barely hanging together, and that's when they sound their best, when the old glue shrinks up and the wood shrinks up and dries out and everything just barely holding up. That's when they can all vibrate their most at their most free, and that's when things usually sound the best. I suppose that's why old instruments sound the way they do. They just develop character after they've been played and been around for a while. The main skill you need to have with working with old instruments is to have a lot of patience, to have a lot of respect for the instruments, and to know what you can do and what you can't do, what's possible to do, to be familiar with the standard techniques, you know, to keep up with the literature and the reading and that sort of thing on what, you know, can be done and can't be done. And just a lot of common sense and just liking to do it. Patience, mainly. I suppose the first thing that attracted me to bluegrass music was the banjo, probably, first of all. Because it's really the flashiest and showiest, probably the fiddle next, but then the mandolin and guitar all have their own qualities. Just the sound of the acoustic instruments playing, the combination of those sounds, because each instrument has its own distinctive sound, and when they're combined, they have a combination that's probably appealing in the same way that a good string quartet is or something. Although it's a little more varied than that, because they're all plucked except for the violin or the fiddle. And then later on, I suppose people get, I got turned on to the subject matter. Sometimes the subject matter is a little corny in a lot of ways, that sort of thing. But it's down to earth and real, that sort of thing. I think I like that. Bluegrass music really started in Europe and in Africa. Basically way back, because bluegrass music is a combination of European folk music and also of blues, which I suppose have their roots in Africa. And it was kind of put together. The two main influences have always been around and still are. They were basically put together by Bill Monroe back in the late 20s and early 30s. That's when bluegrass music really took form as bluegrass music, even though it has its roots in a lot of different areas. I think the solo aspect of in bluegrass music evolved from the realization on the part of musicians in the bands, especially in Bill Monroe's early bands, that each instrument had its own value as a solo instrument, that it had its own virtuosic quality, that wanted to be featured and each note to be heard and not cluttered or distorted or covered by something else. So each instrument then would be featured in its own right, and you could get the full value of each musician's ability and also the sound of the instrument. You can really tell like the difference between the banjo and the mandolin, the guitar and the fiddle, that type of thing. And it's just a great feeling to play and to have people enjoy it. I don't meditate or anything like that, but I think it serves some of the same psychological need or function. Because if you can fully concentrate on music, then you erase pretty much, at least for a while, everything else out of your mind, your cares and worries or whatever they may be. That's all gone. So it just kind of has a cathartic cleansing effect on your attitude, I guess. That's one thing. It does a lot of things. That may be part of what it does for me. And it's just fun.
On the site of what was once a thriving tobacco farm in Quincy now stands a building that houses dreams the land once held for area farmers. Only this time, the dream is built on tomatoes, not tobacco.
Well, the county was big in tobacco for a number of years, and tobacco has since left because of simply the cost of raising a crop of tobacco. And there were other areas that the tobacco is now grown, so the county was left in a state of depression agriculturally. So tomatoes came in through some individuals here that were interested in it, got interested in it and studied it, went to South Florida and looked into it. And these individuals pursued it, and you see what we've got now. It's the county is found an industry here that fits with our agricultural land, with the land here.
It's a good area. Well, that's the only one problem we got. It's a short period, short time, and usually there's a market slot in here between South Florida and then say South Carolina, though. And it's a critical of the timing to get the market, to hit the market. And this year they were late in South Florida, and they got a little earlier up north, and it kind of squeezed us there.
Before Gaston County started raising tomatoes, there was a 2-week lull, you might say, in the market or in production of tomatoes. And we fit right in. It's working out so far. We have our bad years like this year, where weather conditions messed everything up.
I've been growing tomatoes here ever since the tomato deal started here in this county, since 76, 77, along in there. And I wanted to increase my acreage along with the other owners in the packing house, and the other packing houses in the area couldn't handle the volume, so we decided we'd get together and put one in ourselves.
In the plant here, we put this process and sort and grade and by size and weight and get them ready for shipment to the northern market.
What we have here, we're washing them in a warm water chlorinated solution. We use the warm water basically to prevent any kind of a shock treatment that the tomatoes might occur out of the field. The chlorinated water does kill any of the bacteria or any other foreign disease that may be on the tomatoes coming into the packing house. As they do come out, they do go up the conveyor system onto the number one pre-grading table. Now what these ladies do up there is basically separating the color from the greens. Normally we do pack a green tomato, but there is some ripes that do come into the house and they do get processed. They then travel further on down and go through a drying solution and putting a coating of light wax that does help shelf life and does protect the tomatoes. They then come on the what they call the number one grading table. What these girls are doing here is taking out the defects such as cuts and bruising and possibly some other possible defects that may deteriorate from the tomato itself. After this process is done, we go through a sizing process. We do pack according to size, small, medium, large, and an extra large. And they go across these sizing belts that are designated by a hole size. You'll see as the small is a smaller hole and it works its way up to the extra large size. Once it leaves the sizers, they do go into the automatic fillers. Now what these automatic fillers do, they automatically weigh them, they stamp the grower number, and they stamp the size on the box. The box then travels around the conveyor system and it has a lid put on it, indicating the type of label that we are packing. After that, it does get palletized on a stack and it goes down and gets strapped, and then it is ready for shipment.
They go all over the United States, Canada, Puerto Rico.
Most of them this year have gone up the East Coast because the West Coast has been supplying the Western states, and so we supply the Eastern states.
I wish we were in the type climate that we could do it year round, but it does help. The packing house does employ local labor. The whole labor force here is local, and I'm just sorry it can't be a little longer season.
It's given a lot of people jobs that did not have jobs. It's, of course, it's seasonal work, but it's still a big help. We employ probably 200 people here for 45 to 60 days.
I feel good. We took a lot of hard work, a lot of teamwork, and everybody pulled together, and we got had a lot of help from the community and a lot of help from all kind of people, and we're realizing what we started, what we set out to do.
Florida's aquatic beauty and warm climate not only make it a great place for people to live, they also make it a veritable paradise for many forms of hazardous insects. Were it not for the safe and effective insect controls developed by the West Florida Arthropod Research Laboratory here in Panama City, our beloved Florida might still belong to the bugs instead of being the number one vacation destination in the world.
Florida is unique in terms the fact that it has over 1.25 million acres of salt marsh, over 1,200 miles of beach shorelines. It has over 3 million acres of freshwater lakes, has 10,000 miles of freshwater streams. And so with all these variations in habitats as well as rainfall, it's very conducive to producing the 67 species of mosquitoes that we have in the state of Florida, of which 11 of them are indigenous to Florida. Of course, all 67 of these mosquitoes are not all vectors of diseases, nor all of them are pests of man, but a large portion of them are.
Life in Florida was considered unbearable, and conditions here were said to defy development less than 100 years ago, largely because of the menace to both health and comfort posed by the huge insect populations.
In 1887, the South lost about 15,000 people as a result of the mosquitoes that inhabited this area. As far back as 1910 was the last recorded outbreak of yellow fever in Florida. The last outbreak of malaria in Florida was recorded in 1948. Even though we still have these two species in Florida, that they are no longer a problem of disease vector in Florida because of the close cooperation between the public health organization, the private practices of doctors, and the research and the controlled mosquito abatement districts in Florida, we have this under control at the present time.
Efforts are also underway at the lab to control the less dangerous but more annoying stable fly, or dog fly as it's called.
The problem is fairly unique to Florida. There's only about three other places in the country or in the world where the dog fly is a people problem. And the reason it is in this part of the country is that we have a primarily east-west shoreline, and it happens to be in close association with a large agricultural area just north of here. Dog fly populations begin to increase with the warm weather in the spring, and the populations continue to grow on through the summer, and by the middle of the summer we've got fairly large populations, large numbers of flies in the farming community. And this also coincides with the shift in the weather patterns, which produces the fronts that move primarily from the northwest to the southeast. Along with these fronts, as they move across the country, they pick up a lot of flies, in particular stable flies. When they get to the coast, they have a hesitancy, or for some reason they don't like to go out over the water, so they tend to stack up along the shoreline. Approximately 200 miles of shoreline from Pensacola to Franklin County is involved in this program. It's an area much too large to cover by a single county, so the state became involved because in order to gain any kind of control, practically all of the area had to be treated in some uniform fashion. The only practical method of achieving that control is with an airplane, because it has to be covered in a fairly rapid time while the flies are stacked up on the beach.
We're conducting research on the control of sand flies and eye gnats, which are also a pest. In some areas of Florida, sand flies is the number one pest rather than mosquitoes.
Here at the laboratory, all of our initial screening on insecticides for all of our insects, including stable flies, mosquitoes, sand flies, and eye gnats, begin here with the wind tunnel. The apparatus has an exhaust fan at the top, which passes a 3 mile per hour wind through the tunnel. The insecticides are diluted down in a series of insecticide dilutions from more toxic to least toxic, and then we have one check that has nothing except the diluent, no toxicant whatsoever in the compound. All right, the cages are placed into the wind tunnel, and the suction of the wind keeps the apparatus closed. We carefully pipette 1/2 mL of liquid from the pipette into the DeVilbiss nozzle, which actually creates a pressure sprayer. We remove the cage of treated insects, and then we place them into a box containing CO2 gas. The insects remain in here for about 5 seconds, and it puts the insects to sleep. We then transfer the knockdown insects into a clean cage, and then we count the number of flies that die. Usually the more toxic compounds have 100% mortality, and then we come on down to the check compounds that we hope have no mortality. We then run a probit analysis, statistical methods, on the flies to determine an LD50. That is the dosage range that is required to kill 50% of the insects.
We monitor these strains from various areas of Florida to determine their continued susceptibility to these compounds at the recommended dosages and the methods of, that is being applied. There's thousands of chemicals available, but we only have 5 to 7 that we can utilize for public health pest control at, safe, at the present time because of their safety.
Including ongoing attempts to identify the effect pesticides have on sensitive non-target organisms, Florida's pest control program ranks as one of the most active and effective in the world. The methodology developed here in Panama City has helped public pest problems in many other areas.
Artist Ken Shaw has been taking his art to the streets, to the woods, to the coast. He's a graffiti artist, and what that means is you never know where his art will turn up next.
Well, I didn't come from a real traditional background, like from art school or anything, so I just sort of like started drawing anywhere I could. At first, I would draw on these little pads and so forth, and then I just started drawing on the, in the sidewalks and on the street corners. Just because I got, I just wanted to do something that wasn't so conceptualized and caught in little museums and everything like that. And just something that would, like, stop your mind in your everyday life. You're going to work, you're, so everybody's, you know, has their problems, but if they can see a little bit of color or something, you know, it just stops them for a moment and gives them something, you know. Well, the risks are becoming making a fool out of yourself in front of a lot of people. And then one time I was at the Capitol and I had did a drawing there and I called it Affinity, and I was like in the process of doing it up on the where the parking garages are, and the Capitol security had descended on me and grabbed me, took me down there, and they asked me if I had been, you know, to Chattahoochee and I had mental problems. And they called a friend of mine to check up and see if I was really who I was. And, you know, and they asked me what that word meant. And and I got into a lot of trouble there. So I've stayed away from the Capitol a little bit. And I've been staying away from interviews mainly, too, because of that. It becomes too high profile. But sometimes you can get into a lot of trouble. I've had people rip them down and, you know, and stuff like that. I stopped doing them for a while, for a long time. I started them about 10 years or so ago, and then I'd stop for a long time. And then I do one every once in a while and try to keep them fresh and not keep them too overbearing, you know, because you don't want to totally take over the scene. You just want to give it a little light to it, a little bit of something, you know, that's not there normally. And sometimes people say, you know, I'm really tired of looking at that, you know, or someone will really say they really like it. They really, it's really nice, you know. And I don't really know why I do it other than just to feel something there. I don't know. I guess it's everybody has that part that just wants to do something out of the small confines of their everyday existence. Because I have a normal other, the more formalized artist thing going, where I have a show going and sell my paintings at perhaps too high prices or whatever. So this is like something for my own freedom as well. Sometimes I'll see somebody look at something and they, you know, they'll smile or they'll step back a little bit or and they'll laugh or they'll do something, you know. And the reaction is, it's great, you know, it's something, you know. Sometimes you have a show in it, like, not, you can't have a show every day, like in a museum. So with this, you have a reaction almost every day. If you, something, it touches, that's what's nice about art in the public, because it touches everybody who wouldn't ever go into a museum, who really can't relate to anything in the art. You know, they're busy making $1 million or feeding their kids or something like that. But here, it touches their everyday life, and so you get more reactions. And sometimes I do get some big things when someone says, I really like it, you know. Or the other day, I was bringing some paintings up, and this fellow asked me if I had done this particular thing in this alleyway, and I said I did, and he really liked it, you know. And so that's sometimes like that. You know, the ones that don't like it, you get to hear it in the back out, somewhere else, trickles back to you.
Where are some of the places you've put your paintings over the years?
Well, once my father gave me a 1967 black Cadillac convertible in L.A., and I drove it from L.A., with my friend, from L.A. to Tallahassee, and I did drawings all across the country, and I did them in Taos and different little places, little poems and drawings and stuff like that. So that was the greatest kind of like one sweep thing, and I took photographs of them, but unfortunately, the photographs I took of them were like, I took right next to them. I didn't realize. I took them right up to them, you know, and took the photographs. It could have been in your backyard, you know what I mean, for anybody new. And I didn't take a very good pictorial essay, but I did that, and I've done them in Miami and places like that.
You've been faceless for the past 10 years. Your art has been out, it's been on the sidewalks, on the streets, on garbage cans, but Kenny Shaw has been invisible. How do you feel about coming out to the public?
Well, I feel real bad about it. You know, I mean, if I wasn't making so much money doing this, I wouldn't come out. But I don't know, a lot of people have been trying to get me to do it, and I don't know why I came out this time exactly. I don't know. It's weird because I'll probably have to leave town now, but this might be my last hurrah here, you know.
What is in the future for you?
I don't know, really. It seemed like I've said that a lot in this thing. I don't know. But the future is just to keep on doing more art and making people, you know, trying to make them relate to it, or me relate to them relating to it, and just keep on working, and keep on busting through, or trying to bust through to different things, you know, instead of like doing the same thing over and over again.
That's Southern Circuit for this week. Thank you for being with us. Join us again next week when we go junkin' at the old-fashioned general store. Until then, from all of us, good night.